Now, cooking with fish can be intimidating and complicated, but when you get it right, it can be delicious.
Yeah, Chef Josh Nyland has made a huge name for himself as a pioneer of cooking with fish from nose to tail. And this morning, he is going to show us a recipe with fish you won't see anywhere. Welcome to Studio 10, Josh.
G'day.
Thanks for having me.
Brilliant.
I'm always a bit dodgy with fish, but I'm convinced that you're going to change my mind today. What are you going to make for us?
Well, we're going to do a double yellowfin tuna cheeseburger. Mouthful, but delicious. Yeah. And perception of thinking that it's fish, it's not going to be fish. Right. It's going to be the meatiest fish you've ever had. So we're going to start. There's a burger of my own up on the screen there.
Oh my gosh, that looks so delicious.
But we'll talk about fish firstly. Like this here, this is the tuna patty.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, when we think about a tuna burger, we're probably thinking tinned tuna.
Yeah.
That might get crumbed, yeah. Get a potato added to it. But what we've done here is we've ground down all the tuna through a mincer, and then we've ended up with a tuna patty. Because if you think about it, no butcher worth his salt would be cutting up an animal, be it a cow, and then taking the loins off its back and then throwing the rest in the bin. But essentially that's what happens with fish.
Yeah.
I mean, you go to any market in the world and you watch a fish get filleted and all of the fish, you know, that isn't the fillet goes in the bin.
This is
my mission, this is my agenda, is to shift the conversation away from, you know, tossing over half of a fish in the bin.
I think this is fantastic. You don't generally think of burgers, though, do you, when you think of fish?
Yeah, that's what I was just going to say. How do you kind of come up with these recipes, or how did you sort of come to kind of this conclusion of making fish burgers?
As we chat, all I've done here is just a little bit of oil and nice hot pan. And ideally, you'd do this on a barbecue, over some coals, get it nice and smoky.
Yep.
But for what we're doing right now, it's nice because you'll be able to achieve this at home. Really brown on one side and then flip it over, put the cheese on, and then we'll be putting together the burger. But, you know, fish, I think, and the creation of some of the recipes that we've done over the last 6 years with St. Peter, everything's been born out of, you know, being stimulated to affect change with what goes in the bin.
Yeah.
I mean, even if you look at the world's fish that gets caught globally, you've got 50% of the fish that gets captured gets thrown in the bin.
I find that just unbelievable.
And that's from a capture point of view.
Yeah.
And then half of that goes to the market ends up getting tossed as well, just because it doesn't fit the brief. So for us, we're trying to create desirability around all of the parts of the fish. So this one here doesn't actually have any of the center cut, beautiful piece of the tuna.
Mm.
It's got all the sinewy parts from the tail. It's got bits from around the collar and the head. And then all the really sinewy muscle parts from down the side of the fish. So a tuna is really low yielding in the sense that to get that perfect circle tuna steak at the market, you know, you have to carve out quite a lot. And what we end up with is we're creating something that we all recognise as being, you know, delicious and familiar. And, yeah, I think it's been...
Maybe these are the bits that I've been missing out on all the time.
Absolutely.
Because I'm dead keen on the rest of these.
So this is, I suppose, the next part that we haven't talked about.
I was going to ask, so what is this in particular?
All right, so this is bacon.
Yeah, you know what it is.
But the bacon we've made out of Murray cod.
There you go, see.
Beautiful Murray cod out of Griffith in New South Wales. And what we've done is smoked it, we've brined it, and then we've matured and dried it so that the moisture comes out of it for around 4 to 5 weeks. And then at the end of that, we fry it up, like we're doing now, and then pop that on top.
Oh, double trouble.
Slide that over.
Oh, the pig of the sea. Put it on.
Because you've made quite a name for yourself within the chef world of fish and cooking with fish. Do you have any advice for other sort of budding chefs, like myself?
But it's a funny thing, fish, for people as well, so it's...
Yeah.
So any advice for sort of you know, cooking with fish?
I mean, I think the advice probably needs to extend itself to the industry. And, I mean, that's not overly helpful for you who wants to cook better. But I do hope that the work that we do with writing books and, you know, communicating like we are right now, that we can actually affect some kind of change with how much fish is being wasted.
Yeah.
And it's through thinking simply of a fish more as an animal. Because the work of a meat butcher, even if it's from a communication standpoint of walking into a butcher and go, g'day, what are we having for dinner? And they're like, well, we just made some sausages. Do you want some sausages? And I think the same relationship needs to be felt with the way that fish gets handled and processed.
Nice.
So
Let's handle this fish.
Yeah, absolutely.
Can you get stuck into it there? I'll tell everyone what the crack is. If you want to have a taste of Josh's incredible creations, check out Charcoal Fish, or you can even head to the fish butchery to have a crack at making it yourself. You really should. Josh Nyland, thanks so much for joining us today.
Look at that.
Thank you.
It's a chocolate around that one. Going like I said, the pick of the sea. I'm definitely going to taste it.
Isn't that a good brekkie?
I love it, yeah.
Mm.
Go on.
Really good.
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 There we go. Better than Spag Bol.